there and say I was reminded of when I was a young man. When I was 18, 19 years old, and, you know, hey, that was 20 years ago. It's hard to believe for me, I mean, kind of going, but that was 20 years ago.
Maybe.
But I was reminded about how obsessed I had become of accumulating wealth. From the moment that even I turned 16 and I started working my first job, I became obsessed with making money. I wanted to make money because I wanted all these things. I wanted to have a nice car. I wanted to be able to have all this cool electronics or whatever. And at that time, you know, computers were, you know, not everybody still even had a home computer in their home. Not everybody had a personal computer. But all I wanted to have my own computer, I wanted to have a TV in my room, I wanted to have all these different things. But I was really, I mean, I was sitting there thinking, oh, when I move out of the house, I want to be able to have my own house, and I want to have this in it, and I want to have that in it. And I was just sitting there thinking about all these things that I wanted. And this even continued even into my, you know, 18, 19, 20, this continued on for many years. Even, you know, as got married, had kids, I became very obsessed with it. And I worked hard for it. I mean, I worked very hard for it. It wasn't one of those stories where I wanted all the stuff but I expected it to be handed to me. I worked really hard for it. I worked unbelievable hours, bent over backwards, and I will have to say, did some things that I'm not very proud of in order to accumulate more of it. You see, at the time, I worked for a very successful small business owner. He had the big, beautiful, I went to work for him, they drove nice cars, they were building this $500,000 house out of the nice ritzy subdivision of town. They took fantastic, fabulous vacations. They did all these types of things, had nice things, had all the cool, I mean, their house had the whole home theater inside of it and had the pool table, and we had wiring throughout the whole house, and just, it was unbelievable the stuff that was sitting in here, sitting right off the ninth fairway of the one golf course in town. And he kind of took me underneath his wing, and he started to teach me everything that he knew. And I was obsessed with this. And I was eager. And I was just soaking it up like a sponge. I was kind of like, just teach me. Teach me everything you know, because I want to have that. I want to have that one day. Unfortunately, some of the things that he knew and some of the things he taught me, I didn't need to know. We were a small printing company, and we were trying to survive in a changing economy, in a changing world. Technology and demands were changing all around us. Other shops like ours were closing up left and right. And I worked with him side by side, not only to keep what we had, but to make it bigger, make it stronger, to make us more money. And I stood in the sidelines and watched as countless other businesses, organizations, and people were cheated time and time again. There was one time in particular I remembered, we had a big job. This business we brought in on an average $30,000 to $35,000 a month in sales. And we had this one job alone that we came in and we retailed and sold this job for around $14,000 to $15,000. One job. So you can imagine, it was a big deal for us. Well, it was such a big job, we couldn't do it ourselves. We had to send it off to a larger print shop to have it printed. And I had worked and I had found this great little, you could call mom and pop print shop in West Virginia. This company, this couple, sweet, great couple, had started this company from nothing, had built it and worked up through the years, and they built a rather large company. But they were the most sweetest, honest people that you could have. I loved doing business with them. And they sold us jobs at unbelievable rates that allowed us to make really good money off these jobs. And so we sent them this job the one day, and we get it back, and it was cases and cases and cases that we get back, and we open this job up, and it's been printed on the wrong paper. They wanted some really fancy, glossy paper, and it was on this just dull, matted paper. And we start freaking out a little bit, and we realize it's not our fault. It was their mistake. So the owner calls up the company and tells them, you've got to reprint this job. Never contacts our customer, never does anything, and says, you know what? You guys messed this up. What are you going to do about it? I need this reprinted. I don't want a discount on this job. I don't want you to come pick it up. And he knew they weren't going to spend the money to come pick up a job that was useless to them. Why spend the money and all that? And so I watched as this company sat here, it's this mom and pop company, sat there and went, yeah, all right, we'll reprint it for you at no cost. It was our fault. And they rush it, get us back into it. And he goes to our customer, he goes, okay, here's your job. And if you're interested, I've got another whole load of them over here. I'll sell you at 50% off. Actually, it was more than 50%. I think you only gave about a 30% discount on that. And I watched as this mom and pop company lost money. Sweet couple lost all this money on this job so that he could swindle his way around to make himself a few extra bucks. And that was just one of many, 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 many stories where people were swindled out of money. People were griped at, chewed out on the phone because in order to try to get a price a little cheaper. Corners were cut. It was not a good environment. And as we've been walking through these commandments, you'll see this one commandment, the next commandment, the eighth commandment that we're on, in verse 14, says, do not steal. Basically, this commandment is telling us it's wrong to take from another what is rightfully another person's business. What is their property? The thing is, I think one of the biggest problems that we can run into with this commandment in this day and age, in this world that we live in, is the lack of understanding of ownership. We live in a world that ownership, much like everything else now, is left up to interpretation. Do they really own it? Do they not? I wanted it more than they did. I helped build this, so I own it. I helped do this, so I own it. It doesn't matter if you paid and bought for it. If someone else wants it bad enough, they're going to find a way to justify, to twist the truth to their reality, to make it right in their eyes. But as we look at this commandment, we realize this commandment isn't confined to just mankind. This commandment isn't just confined to me and you, to each other. Like all these other commandments we've seen, this also has to do with our relationship with God. I said, we've seen that time and time again with these different commandments. We cannot have a functional relationship with each other apart from God.
Amen.
He is the binding, the peace that keeps us in a functional relationship with each other. If you look at the world and you see chaotic relationships, where's God at in that relationship? Not to say that you're not going to have bumps along the way. Not that we're not going to have disagreements and arguments, but how we handle them, how we go about doing things, yes, our relationship with God is going to affect that. And our revelation, God can also, it will eliminate some of the bumps, some of the issues that we have, some of the arguments, some of the things. Because it eliminates the problem in the first place. In this particular case, it eliminates, well, that was mine. What do you think that's mine? That's not yours, that's mine. This commandment fundamentally recognizes that the Lord owns everything in heaven and earth. As I said, we sometimes struggle with the concept of ownership. But ultimately, God owns everything. Amen. It says in Psalm 24, verse 1, says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to Him." And even then says in Psalm 115, it says, "The heavens belong to the Lord, but He has given the earth to all humanity." It's His. He's loaned it to us. That's all it is. And you know, sometimes we have a tendency that we only think about that in money. We sit there and go, well, we know it's not our money. We know that it's God's. He's blessed us. He's given it to us. He's loaned it to us. We're stewards of the money that God's given us. But it goes beyond just money. It goes into everything that we possess. Fundamentally belongs to God. But we live in a world that that's not the mindset, that's not the thinking. I work for it, it's mine. I will do with it what I please, how I want to. And then we even twist it and pervert it into things where people start to take things that aren't even theirs. These passages in Psalms have to do with the requirement of true worship. The object of true worship is established with the claim to the universal sovereignty for God. He is ruler of all. There are no limitations to the authority and dominion of God. No limitations. You see, there can be no justification. There can be no way of us trying to make things right in our minds when we're dealing. We can't even do it when we're dealing with each other. There is no way to justify taking something that is not yours. Especially when you start talking about it and you bring God into the picture. There's no justification at that point in time. Because let's face it, we have nothing and deserve absolutely nothing. Actually, I take that back. There is one thing that we deserve. And that is punishment and judgment. Not to be Mr. Doom and Gloom, but that is what we deserve. Our natural state deserves that. That's why we drink from that cup of redemption. That's why Christ's body was broken. That's why he was sacrificed on that cross. And we didn't deserve one little bit of it. We didn't deserve any sacrifice, let alone someone giving their life for us. Because I said, we have that tendency that we start to think that we deserve things. But the closer we get to God, the more and more we learn that we don't deserve anything, and we really fundamentally don't know anything either. I remember at one point, and as I was going through school, I remembered at one point, this realization that just hit me, and I went, man, it seems like the more I learn, the less I know. Because I learned very quickly that the more I scratched off God, the deeper and deeper and deeper it got. The more and more there was to Him. You see, the world doesn't operate on this understanding. And so we find people breaking this commandment by multiple different things. Examples: lying on their taxes. Some people go, well, that's what the government deserves. No, we're not lying on our taxes. Taking advantage of someone when selling something or any other business deal. Just like that moment when that owner took advantage of that sweet couple that had made an honest mistake. And what's unbelievable is when you reached out to the customer went, oh yeah, great, we love that. We don't really care what paper it's printed on. They didn't even care. No, I agree. Something needed to be done. They should have been compensated. Something should have gone into that. But I'm going to tell you, there was no business ethics going on in that situation. Morality was out the window in that particular situation. One of the other ways we do, paying lower wages than deserved. You know, we live in a world now that we have to write laws to tell us to do the right things. You know, we sit here, we get all up in arms, we talk about things, but let's face it, the world was listening to this commandment. This world was listening to do not steal. We would have employers properly compensating employees, and we would not need a government to come in and dictate and tell us this is what you have to pay your employee. We would naturally be doing the right thing on our own. We would not need a government to come in and do that. But it happens. People take advantage of other individuals. We can even now bring in even adultery. We talked about that last week. We talked about how in adultery, and we're talking about our mate, and we're talking about possession, and that while we may not actually be property owned by somebody, but we do belong to somebody. And it's just like we belong to God. We are property of God. We belong to Him. And yet we don't sometimes treat ourselves like that, let alone treat other individuals like they belong to God. We're not treating God's property the way that we should. Another way that we can do it, and I'm telling you, and maybe I don't want to open up a can of worms on this one, but not doing the work or level of work you are paid to do. We unfortunately, and I'm not, I don't want to go sidetracked, again, I don't want to go, oh, the world's coming to an end type thing, but are living in a world right now where we have a lot of young people that do not understand the cause and effect. They don't understand if you want to make this money, you have to earn it. You don't automatically deserve it. Amen. You want these benefits, you earn them. It's not a requirement. You have teenagers and kids now walking around going, one of these is my right. I have a right to one of these. We also have kids that are walking around going, this is a right too. Give me a car. It's my right. Yeah. Pay the insurance, buy the gas, do all that type of stuff. Oh, it's my right to have a video game system in my room. But let's face it, it doesn't just end with teenagers. We have adults that do the exact same thing. This is what I deserve. Now give it to me. I know I haven't earned it. But let's face it, fundamentally, the way we can break this commandment is by the love of money or physical possessions. That is the basic sin condemned with this commandment. Now, I do want to make sure to note here, because this is one of those points where I think it's been twisted at different points throughout history, and different organizations and different people will twist this. You know, oh, you don't need to own anything, you need to give it to us, because any physical attachment, any ownership, any possession of wealth is not a good thing, so donating and give it to us. That story's been told for who knows how many years. There is nothing wrong with the accumulating and building of wealth. Fundamentally, there is nothing wrong with the accumulating and building of wealth. But there's a little, almost like a contract, there's a little thing that goes along with that. There's a little subline in there that says, there's nothing wrong with accumulating and building wealth, but you must be generous. John Wesley himself said, make all you can, save all you can, and give all you can. You know, like I said, make all you can. There's nothing wrong with accumulating and building wealth. But there's a certain point where it can become such a priority for us to either acquire or to retain. I want to make sure I put that in there. Not only accumulate, but retain. start doing things that are living our lives in ways that we don't need to be doing. We can be making decisions. We can start to make some of those lines a little fuzzy and kind of going, oh, no, the line wasn't right there. It was right here. And now I'm okay. I erased that. See, that was really where I meant to draw. That was really where the line was supposed to be at. We start to justify those things. We start to cheat people. Or maybe it's not even about what we take from somebody, but maybe it's what we don't give at the same time. You see, it's when you begin to put your money above your love of God, your obedience to God, that's when you have an issue. You see, John Wesley got it. John Wesley got it. But he also knew that you had to give all you can. And when you gave, you got something even greater in return. As I said, as we've been going through these commandments, that's one of the big things that we've been doing is with every do, there is a do not. With every do not, there is a do. So just because Scripture says, do not steal, and you went, well, I haven't gone into a store, pulled a gun on anybody, so I'd stick them up and stolen something. Or I haven't gone into a store and went, ooh, I want that, and shoved it in your pocket. I haven't stolen, I'm good. But what's the do? This is a do not, so what is the do? And that's exactly what it was. Be generous. Be generous with what you give. When was the last time you lavished somebody with generosity? When was the last time you lavished somebody with generosity that didn't deserve it? We sit here and we talk about how God has lavished us. He's given us more than what we need. He has more than satisfied us. But we didn't deserve it. You know, when was the last time we lavished somebody that much? And lavished that person that maybe just honestly just didn't deserve it at the time. And remember, lavish means to be elaborate, luxurious, grand, costly, splendid, regal, ornate, expensive. When was the last time we were lavish with our generosity? You know, that was one of the things that we've been doing with our little blessings cards. Lavish somebody. Bless that person. Be generous towards somebody. Because when you do, it's unbelievable what you get back in return. And again, that's not the reason why we do it. It's not to get something back from God. It's one of those things, you know, I've heard the saying, you know, like we said earlier, we're stewards of all God's stuff, right? And I've heard people preach this way, to where they go, well, we're all stewards, so God's only going to give you what you're a good steward of. So if you want more stuff, be a good steward. And I'm going, I think that's a byproduct. That's not the mission. That's not the point. Is to go out so you can accumulate more. God, look what I'm doing. I'm giving everything away. Give me more. I want more than I gave away. And that's the mentality. You hear that a lot on TV. You hear that a lot with the TV. Some of the TV ministers and organizations. That was notorious for years. Give us $100 and God will give you $1,000 in return. We have to make sure that our reasons and causes are right. Are righteous, first and foremost. Our reasoning cannot be self-serving. Nothing about God is self-serving. And so anything we do, if we lavish somebody with generosity, it cannot be for our own personal gain. It totally rules it all out. What was it? I think it was an episode of Friends, the TV show Friends that was on years ago. And there was a girl in there, she's trying to make this argument that there's no good deed. Because as soon as you get a pat on the back, you've gotten a reward, and a good deed does not deserve a pat on the back. It does not receive deserved recognition. She took it even to the point where even the warm feeling that you get inside is a reward. And it was a funny episode, and I don't agree with everything in there, but it brings across the truth. It brings across an aspect there. We have to make sure we're doing it for the right reason. We have to make sure that it's truly generosity. If somebody gives it back to us, if somebody does what we want them to do with it, great. But that's not the reason why we do it. So I asked that question again. When was the last time that we were generous? Lavish with our generosity. When was the last time that we were very generous with somebody that didn't deserve it? You see, the greatest safeguard of protecting ourselves from breaking this commandment, the greatest thing to keep us from stealing, from starting to make gray lines, to be able to be obsessed with this accumulation, is to have a generous heart. If you have a generous heart, if you have a heart like Jesus, the generous heart of Christ, that's the greatest safeguard to protect yourself from violating this commandment, is to have a generous heart. So as we close this morning, again, I don't know where everybody's going to be at, where you fall in line with that. Again, I doubt anybody in here has gone in and performed, you know, armed robbery, or, you know, they kleptomaniac where they just got to pick everything up and shove it in their purse or in their pocket. I don't really figure that's where we're dealing with that particular issue. If we are, I'll be available after the service if you need to talk. But I think for most of us, what we have to look at in this is, am I doing the do in the do not? Am I being generous? Am I doing it lavishly? Am I protecting myself from this? Because the facts are, it's only with a pure heart. It's only with a pure heart that obedience can be perfect. Let me say that again. It is only with a pure heart that obedience can be perfect. And how do we have a pure heart? We have the heart of Christ.
Pastor, I've got a text. I just wanted to inform my family here that my daughter's husband's mom is going into surgery tomorrow. She's having a triple bypass. So if y'all can keep her in her y'all's prayer. Her name is Miss Good. That's her name. I apologize.
We need to know those things. We need to be able to pray for each other. And the thing is, that's being generous with our time. That's how we can be generous sometimes with our time, is to be making sure to pray for individuals, to be remembering those individuals. Because it's easy to get distracted even with our time. So as we leave here this morning, I ask that question. How obedient are we being when it comes to our possessions? When it comes to our generosity. When it comes to our possessions. How obedient are we being? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to an end this morning, Lord, as we look at this commandment, it can look like a relatively simple commandment, just like so many of them are. But Lord, you intended so much more for us. You meant so much more for us. Lord, you want us to have an obedient heart. You want us to have a generous heart. Fundamentally, Lord, you want us to have a heart like yours. And you are the most generous being in the world, in creation, Lord, it all comes from you. You have set the bar, you have set the standard. And may we spend our lives trying to meet that bar, to be able to meet the level of generosity that you have already exampled for us, that you've already bestowed upon us. Lord, we love you. We say that over and over and over again. I can't say it enough, Lord. I love you. I love you more than I can even begin to express. But may it be more than my words here this morning. May my love be delivered in action here this morning. May I go out into this world and may I do more than just share your love through my lips, the words that are spoken, but may I do it through my actions at the same time. Lord, thank you for setting the example. Thank you for showing us the way. Lord, be with each and every one of us as we leave this place, as we go out into this world, as we love as you have loved. In your holy and beautiful name. Amen.
Stand and sing in closing today.